I just have to start off by saying fantastic work, my friend.
Thank you very much.
This had to have been quite an emotional role to play.
Yeah.
Could you feel the emotions?
Definitely. I mean, it's an interesting role to play because he goes through so much trauma and goes through so many crazy experiences. And dealing with that as an actor is, of course, very interesting and difficult. But I mean, offset, I did always feel a little emotionally drained. But I think that's a good thing, because otherwise it wouldn't have meant I was putting my all into it and giving it my emotional power that I could.
So true. You know, it is a coming-of-age story.
Yeah.
But it is also a unique one.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just curious, what did you like most about that aspect of it?
I mean, of course, it's always fun to play a character that goes a little crazy at times. I mean, it's Boris and I, as the two younger people in the film, do a lot of reckless things, and being able to portray that is a lot of fun. But of course, don't do that at home. I mean,
no, yeah, but you know, it is also kind of a reality because of the things that were going on in your world. And I'm glad you brought up you and young Boris, because I wanted to also say Texas isn't that bad. There's a lot, and you're laughing. When my producer's with me, and we were both at the screening this afternoon, and when the line came up about, oh, you're going to Texas, they have the death penalty, and we can walk in Texas, by the way.
Yeah.
So anyway, that line kind of struck me as funny.
It's not my character, don't worry about it.
No, I know, but I laughed. I'm going to get on him about that when I talk to him. How familiar were you with the story before taking on this role?
I was not familiar myself until, obviously, I read the script and then digested as much of the book as I could. But my mom was very familiar before I even did any auditions or anything. She had read the book and was absolutely in love with it and loved the story and really connected with it. And she was immediately like, you have to do this, you have to do this. This is an incredible story. It's going to be an incredible movie. You have to be a part of it. And I was very excited to, and then, of course, using the incredible script and team of incredible writers that developed that, and being around so many awesome people, it was a lot of fun, and it was really awesome to be a part of it.
Well, they say moms are always right, and she definitely was right in this one as well. I'll close with this. You play a young Theo. You're the older, is portrayed by Ansel Elgort. Did you work together with him to kind of develop the character together, or was it important to keep it separate as the younger and the older version?
We did do a bunch of rehearsals towards the beginning. I did rehearsals with all of different walks of people that I interact with in the film. But Ansel and I also did rehearsals together, even though we don't interact. It was really helpful to see each other work through the different scenes because we saw how each other work, and we kind of saw how we responded to direction and just kind of developed a character through that, which was a lot of fun and really probably a good thing. But at the same time, John kept us separate so we wouldn't get too similar, because there's a big gap of time that passes between my portion and then Ansel's portion. And Ansel's still trying to piece himself back together, but he is farther along in that process, where younger Theo is still derailing and kind of going in a downward spiral.
My friend, I will tell you, fantastic job, but what a task. Yeah, how do you turn an 800-page book, I think it's 800 pages, could be even closer to 1,000, best-selling book like that into a film? I mean, what's the biggest challenge?
With difficulty is the answer to that difficult question. The biggest challenge is, of course, what to leave out. And you know, that you could easily do a 10-hour mini-series based on that book. But I think that you know, Peter Strawn had a very clear instinct, or screenwriter, that by focusing in on two periods of the story, in the immediate aftermath to the bombing and the point at which it's all rattling to pieces when Theo's a young adult, that one would be able to best sort of serve the more dramatic parts of the book. And there's a big chunk in the middle where, after he returns from Vegas, where it's less dramatically interesting. It's brilliant prose writing, and it's very interesting in terms of his own internal development, but arguably less events in that. But, you know, the other thing it gave us was letting go of a linear time structure, and the book is written in a linear form, was the big step towards transposing it onto a screen and making it cinematic. And by having an ability to then cut back and forth and have a chance at expressing Theo's internal emotional dilemma, that was the big key.
Donna Tartt is the author of the book, best-selling book, novel. Many people have read it. Everybody knows about that story, or, you know, and waiting for this film. How involved was Donna with you getting this done?
Not at all. I mean,
really?
I met her once, which was when I was in the process of being given the job, as it were, and I became Nina Jacobson and Warner Brothers' sort of director of choice. They went and presented me to Donna in Charlottesville. So I met her once there and had lunch, and which was amazing to meet her. And we had a great conversation, and the screenplay had existed at that point, the first draft of the screenplay. And we discussed in detail the story. And then I got back on a plane, and when I got back to London the next morning, the film had been announced. So I'm guessing I got the thumbs up along the way. So that was it.
This is a crime drama. Mm. It's a coming-of-age type film. It's so much more than that, too. And I'm just, as a director, what drew you to that, and what makes this film more than just a crime coming-of-age type story?
I'm drawn to stories that don't get easily pigeonholed into one genre. And I have a huge admiration for people who can do straight-up genre fare. But it's much more interesting and much more challenging if you can collapse between various genre and hold on to an emotional story at the core of it. And I think that that's rather pleasurable for audiences as well, is that then they sort of feel the pleasure of traveling through various different types of film. And you're right, there's a coming of age story in this, and there's also a rather dark, noirish underworld story in Amsterdam. And then there's this sort of story about grief and loss in New York, and about his sort of rebirth and education culturally, and learning what's of use visually and tactically in the world, and I mean as in Kobe teaches him what old things, the importance of old things. And there's something in the story which is about the importance of what's real as opposed to what's illusory. And Hobie teaches him that, and of course Theo gets involved in this very sort of nefarious area of passing off things which are not quite real as real. And that central dilemma in the story goes right back to the thing that I loved when I first read the book, which is it's a brilliant study in grief, and a very original one, that the kid gets stuck in his grief of losing his mother, and this object which reminds him of his mother takes on enormous importance. But his dilemma, of course, is that object happens to be a priceless work of art, and the longer he keeps it, in a way, the more criminal he becomes as it goes on, you know. And somehow it's not just that, it's just a melodrama about him turning into a sort of, you know, art thief. Somehow that criminality speaks to the bit of himself which mistakenly blames himself for having killed his mother. It's like it makes him feel like a criminal. So this whole tissue of lies and falseness that grows up around him becomes the heart of the story.
I'm looking over your shoulder and I'm seeing the painting. I had no idea. While this is a work of fiction, the novel that it's based on, the painting is real, and I didn't know that till just now.
And here it is, Carol Fabricius's The Goldfinch.
So should I grab it and run out and try to sell it? No, I'm kidding.
You could try.
So my opening question, I don't know how much I can for it. I don't want people to rush in here now. So my opening question to you is, what does the symbol, the goldfinch, mean to you?
This is a question that I could spend absolute decades answering you on, but for the interest of time, I guess for me it's it kind of speaks to the contradictions that exist in life. You know, we have this radiant little bird, and it's kind of in all of its beauty, and then it's chained to its perch. And I feel like Pippa's a little bit like this, and life is a little bit like this, in that we are flawed mortal human beings, and death is inevitable, and all of these tragedies and the underbelly of existence can kind of, the circumstances hit us here time and time again, but somehow we have to find a way to rise above the pain, and we have to look out and forth into the world and forge a life through it, and both appreciate and preserve beauty amongst all of the pain that can also accompany it. So, I mean, there's a million different layers that I could talk about, but that's just one of them.
But it also, and something that I took away from this movie was, yes, that life does happen,
yeah.
But it's also the people that interact with you, and specifically with your character, you can rely on people to kind of guide you and help you through. It's kind of like when you think you're, I feel like Oprah Winfrey today.
Please.
No, but that's really how
this is what the film does.
Yes.
I know.
And I was like, no, you may have it bad, but it could be worse.
Right.
And you need the people around you. Am I right?
Yeah, I think that's the magic of the book and the film is that it's just full of meaning. It forces you to examine life in so many different directions and facets, and there's so much that can be pulled from it. But yeah, you see Theo with these kind of versatile landscapes and people and fascinating characters that guide him through this kind of this life. But yeah, it's I think also what I love about it, and it exists in this painting, exists in the Rembrandts and the Vermeers, is that it's both life and death together. And I don't think, like, the painting is beautiful and it's tragic, and I think it's about the fullness of life for me. It's not about, you know, the one or the other. It's I think the film does this as well. It really asks you to experience life in a deeper way with its, you know, the highs and the lows, and not just focus on one or the other.
When you first read this script,
yeah,
what were you thinking? Because we're going to get it. We're going to dissect this story,
yeah,
and talk about the painting behind you here in a minute. But I want to know what your first impression was.
I just saw a truth in the complexity of humanity, really. And a brutality of what can happen when you have people trying to survive and try to find out who they are. And for me, anything that grounds back to just us as humans, and for me as an actor, that's what's really tasty, you know, to pick up. You know, you get to really play around with that. And then, of course, it was knowing, you know, it's like John Crowley was directing, and then the cast that was being put together, it just felt like a very happy family to be part of.
You know, it's based on a very popular novel, and I keep going like this because I'm looking at the painting behind you, and which is a real painting, I found out after seeing this movie.
Okay, yeah.
It's a real painting. There
yeah,
is a
yeah.
real goldfinch.
Fabricius, yeah.
Yeah, so what is that painting, what does the goldfinch mean to you now that you've lived this story?
Yeah, it's hard because the painting automatically makes me think of Boris, but then me as a person, you know, the painting resembles being chained to things which are stopping you from growing, you know. Like, as you see in the painting, that tiny little chain that is tied to that beautiful bird's, you know, ankle, foot, is restricting it from doing what naturally it's supposed to be doing, which is flying around, you know, in the sky. And I think that resembles so many different obstacles that we create for ourselves in our own lives as people. And we all have our different, you know, things. We all have different baggage. It's all relevant. We all have struggles. And it's finding how do we unclip ourselves from the chains that we create for ourselves.
What was it like working with this incredible cast, you included? You know, there's the I would imagine at the end of the day, you're just kind of like, because there's a lot of emotions at play.
Yeah.
You can rely on other people, really, is one of the other messages in the story, you being one of the characters, friends of Theo.
Yeah.
So working with this cast, what was that like?
It's fantastic, because everyone showed up, you know. Everyone had prepared as well as they could. You know, these are some of the best actors that we've got in the industry. And, you know, I just remember meeting Jeffrey Wright for the first time, and I loved everything that he's ever done. And then meeting him and just seeing him talk through things with John just made me kind of appreciate that we were all bringing something different to the table. And we were all there together trying to elevate the script into a movie and then create, you know, these very intriguing, in-depth characters. So it was a lovely place to be. I just felt like I needed to make sure that I wasn't the one that messed up and dropped the ball. I just wanted to make sure that I was brought off the bench for the right reasons.